Israeli voters delivered a clear message to the White House, the media, and the world. Thanks for your help, but we'll keep our prime minister. What was supposed to be a tight race that favored the leftist Zionist Union turned overnight into a surprisingly strong victory for the nationalist right led by Netanyahu. The prime minister quoted the book of Joel in his victory speech.
I want to thank you all the citizens of Israel, for faith in Israeli democracy, and for the faith in our one and only country. With your help and with the help of God, we will protect her together, and Judah will be inhabited forever, and Jerusalem for all generations.
Facing negative poll numbers and a hostile media, Netanyahu told a large nationalist rally on Sunday that his Likud party could close the gap between his and the leftists and the national parties. It appears he did just that and surprised even his supporters. Every pre-election indicator said Israelis would vote their pocketbooks and vote Labor. But in the end, security concerns prevailed.
I think that the Israeli public understood that despite all the issues and all the problems, when we see the threats of Iran, Hezbollah, and Hamas, the Likud is the best leading party to lead the nation for the next 4 years.
Netanyahu will now bypass parties on the left and try to form a government of the right. But he will have to focus on the high cost of housing and other social issues as well. That contributed to the 24 seats won by Labor and the good showing of Kulanu, a Likud offshoot that the prime minister will need for his majority. Meanwhile, Netanyahu's victory sets Israel and the Obama administration on a potential collision course over Iran. The director of national intelligence just removed Iran and Hezbollah from its list of threat assessments, while Netanyahu calls Iran the number one state sponsor of terror in the world. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Tel Aviv.
Well, Chris is now with us from Jerusalem, along with our CBN News political editor, John Waghi. Guys, good to see you today. What's the mood in Israel? Are people excited? Are they thrilled about this election?
Well, I would say so, Pat. They are thrilled and surprised. I think all of Israelis are surprised at the amount of seats that Netanyahu got. 30 seats is really a landslide in this kind of parliamentary elections. When we were there last night at the Likud headquarters, I think it was Likud supporters themselves were surprised. And I would just add, Pat, you know, our colleague John Waghi, he predicted, I think, the closest of all the pundits. He said they'd get about 27. The polls and pundits were saying about 21, 22. I think this is a huge mandate for Netanyahu right now, and it really does send a message not only throughout here in the region, but also to Washington, D.C.
John, how do you do it, baby? You're always on it. What was your key indicator?
I think it was prayer, Pat, more than anything else. I just had a sense that it was going to be higher than the pollsters were saying, that they were misreading the momentum that came in the last few days. And but I was surprised by the results. And you know, he got 30 seats rather than 27, so it went even above what I thought. And I was about 5 or 6 seats above what the pollsters were saying. So it's really a solid victory that no one had really anticipated.
Well, Chris, he's got to get more than that. Who's going to link in with him in a coalition?
Well, Jewish Home, I think, is one of the parties that he's going to be with. Kulanu is another party. It looks like right now he's going to have a pretty solid center-right majority, maybe 64, 65, maybe even as far as 67 seats. The religious parties will probably come along with him as well. So getting the 30 seats really is a huge deal for him as he cobbles together this coalition. Now, what's going to happen right now, Pat, is Reuven Rivlin, who's the president of Israel, he's going to be the one to tell Netanyahu to go ahead and form a coalition. He'll have about 45 days to do so, and it looks pretty well that he can do that.
John, Netanyahu said in the last week Israel will keep building in Jerusalem and there won't be a Palestinian state on his watch. And that defies Obama's view of the Middle East. What do you see happening?
Well, I think, you know, Chris mentioned in the story being on a collision between Washington and Iran. I think there's also going to be a collision course on the situation vis-a-vis the Palestinians. I think that Netanyahu has made it clear, especially on building in Jerusalem, he is not going to stop especially when they need low-cost housing all around Jerusalem and beyond in Israel, he's not going to stop building in the area that he has said over and over is the eternal undivided capital of Israel. And so I think on that score and on the score of the Palestinians, where Bibi was very successful in arguing that you can't put terrorists on the front's doorstep, and that's what's happened with every land concession. And so I think he's going to take a tough line, and now he has a mandate to take a tough line, basically.
Well, Chris, one more question. He's surrounded. There are other countries, some that look to be somewhat favorable toward Israel, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, and so forth. Are they going to be in any way friendly with him or enable him to go against Iran?
Well, I think so, Pat, and I think that's part of the story going on here. One of the big headlines is the fact of there's rejoicing probably in the capitals of Cairo, Riyadh, and Amman. They won't be doing that publicly, and you won't see that on the streets, but privately, I was talking to one Arab expert earlier today who said, really, they're honoring, the rulers of these countries are honoring the courage of Netanyahu to stand up against Obama, to go to the Congress and speak so forthrightly about Iran. Certainly, they are very, very concerned about the encroachment of Iran, Iran's nuclear program. They don't feel like the U.S. is going to hold the line against the nuclear Iran, and they see really Netanyahu as their ally, maybe unspoken ally, to defend against that. And one other thing, Pat, about this election, I think this was a reaction, as some Israelis were telling me, against the interference of the Obama administration or the White House into this election, and they feel like this was a reaction against that. You know, there's the story about V15, which is that group supported by One Voice, which is funded by the State Department in part. Now there's a Senate investigation going on. 20 U.S. congressmen are asking the State Department for more answers. But I think that's part of the story as well. What's going to happen with the U.S.-Israeli reaction as we go on from here?
Last question. I've wondered and wondered and wondered at what point the Israelis might do some kind of a military strike against the Iranian nuclear facilities, or are they just going to let it go?
Well, I think, Pat, this is one thing that strengthens Netanyahu's hand. These governments like Saudi Arabia, there have been reports, private reports, that maybe they would actually help Israel. For example, Saudi Arabia using letting Israel use their airspace to attack Iran. And also they see the size of the victory, I think, gives them the assurance that Netanyahu does have the support of the Israeli people. Security seemed to trump economics right now in this election. It was close. But I think Israelis, as Danny Danone said in the piece, that it was the security issues, Hamas, Hezbollah, Iran, that really trumped the economic issues.
Thank you, guys. We appreciate your coverage and your watching what's happening.